Hello guys, and welcome to this series on AWS Lambda. In this series, I'll show you the following: how to create and deploy Lambda functions in Python, how to execute the functions with HTTP calls, and lastly, how to integrate Lambda with other AWS services like S3 and much more. In this video, I'll go over the fundamentals of serverless, AWS Lambda, and I'll end the video by creating our first Lambda function in Python. So what are serverless applications? Serverless applications are applications that run without you having to provision or manage the servers, hence the name serverless, meaning without servers. But just because you don't provision or manage the servers doesn't mean they are not there. Your application will still run on the servers, but all the management is done by AWS. The cool thing is that you only pay for the compute time you consume, and therefore there is no charge when your code is not running. In essence, you just upload your code and Lambda will take care of everything required to run and scale your code with high availability. Now let's move on to what is Lambda. Lambda is a compute service where you can upload your code. As mentioned above, your code will then be executed using AWS servers. You also don't have to worry about managing servers. This means that you don't have to worry about what operating system to use, patching, scaling, and high availability. That is all done for you. A simple way to think of Lambda is that it is functions as a service. Your code is called a function on the Lambda platform. Lambda functions can be written in a variety of programming languages such as Java, Python, Go, C#, Ruby, and Node.js. AWS Lambda can be used in the following two ways. The first one, as an event-driven compute service where it runs your code in response to events. These events could, for example, changes to data in an Amazon S3 bucket. The events that come from other AWS services are called triggers. The second way in which AWS Lambda can be used is as a compute service to run your code in response to HTTP requests using Amazon API Gateway or to API calls made using AWS SDKs. In this series, we'll look at both scenarios. Persistence. All the functions that you write on AWS Lambda have to be stateless. This, however, doesn't mean that you can't store any persistent data with Lambda. You can connect with S3 and DynamoDB to store any persistent data. So just how much does AWS Lambda cost? AWS Lambda is covered under the free tier, and AWS gives away a lot for free. You get 1 million requests per month and 400,000 gigabyte seconds of compute time per month for free. Gigabyte second is a unit of measurement that specifies the amount of memory allocated to a task per second that task runs. For example, if the memory allocated is 1 gigabyte, and the task runs for 10 seconds, the compute time consumed would therefore be 1 gigabyte times 10 seconds, which is equal to 10 gigabytes per second. After the first free 1 million requests, the cost then becomes 20 cents per million requests thereafter. And after the first free 400,000 gigabyte seconds, the cost then becomes 0.00001666667 for every gigabit seconds. Remember, with Lambda, if there is no usage, there is no cost. The other cool thing with Lambda is that the free tier does not automatically expire at the end of your 12 months AWS free tier term, but it is available indefinitely. Now that we have a basic understanding of Lambda, let's create our first Lambda function in Python, which simply adds two numbers and displays the result. The first thing that we need to do is just log into the Amazon Management Console. Once in the console, we can search for Lambda here under services and then just click here to launch the Lambda home screen. If your screen is showing something different, you can just go to the top here and search for Lambda and then click on the first result to go to the Lambda home screen. If you already have some Lambda functions, they'll be displayed here. One thing to note here is that AWS Lambda is bound by regions. In this instance, we're trying to create our Lambda function in the Ireland region, and that is where it will reside. If we were to change the region, for example, to Northern Virginia, you'll see any Lambda functions, if any. As you can see, I'm now in the Northern Virginia region, and as can be seen here, I've got a Lambda function that I last modified 9 months ago. Anyway, let's go back to our Ireland region, because that's where I want us to create our Lambda function. To create our Lambda function, just click Create Function here. It will give us three options, for creating the Lambda function, which are author from scratch. The second one is user blueprint, which is building a Lambda application from sample code and configuration presets for common use cases. And lastly, deploy a sample Lambda application from the AWS Serverless application repository. We're going to go with author from scratch, which is already selected. Now we need to give it a name. We're going to call our Lambda calc. So just type calc in there. Next, we need to choose the runtime. The runtime is just the programming language that we are going to use. So click on the dropdown and select Python 3.8. We always try to use the latest and greatest. So Python 3.8 is the latest version of Python as of this recording. Next, we need to give permissions to our Lambda. So just expand, choose, or create an execution role. Permissions in AWS are basically a way to give an AWS user or service, in this case, access to another AWS service. So for instance, we want our Lambda to write its logs to Amazon CloudWatch. Therefore, we need to give it the permissions to be able to access Amazon CloudWatch. We'll again go with the pre-selected option, which is create a new role with basic Lambda permissions. Then click on the create function button here to create our Lambda function. It will take a few seconds to create the Lambda function. It's done now, and it gives you a confirmation here at the top in green that it successfully created the function calc. This page that we are seeing is the Lambda configuration page, and it has got many different sections such as designer, function code, environment variables, tags, and execution roles. The others, if you scroll down. Let's just expand designer and see what is there. As you can see, it allows us to add triggers and destinations. Triggers are the things that can invoke our Lambda function. In the next video, we'll add API gateway as a trigger for our Lambda function. Now let's focus on the function code section. There are four parts to it: the code entry type, the runtime, the handler, and lastly, the online text editor where you can write your code. The code entry type basically asks you how you want to put in the code for the Lambda. It has three options, which are edit code inline, which is pre-selected and is the one that we're going to use. You can also upload a zip file. This allows you to upload a zip file with the Lambda function. And lastly, there's upload a file from Amazon S3. This option allows you to choose a file that you have already uploaded to Amazon S3. The next part is the runtime. As I mentioned earlier, you use the runtime to select the programming language that you'll be using for the Lambda function. We have already selected Python 3.8, and that is the one shown here. But you're able to change the runtime by clicking on the dropdown and selecting from the supported languages there. The third part is the handler information. This just ties in the name of your Python file and the name of the method with the entry point. In this case, the name of the Python file is lambda_function.py, and the name of the handler is Lambda Handler. You can name your Lambda Handler anything you want, but just remember to also update it here on the handler so that AWS will be able to launch it. AWS Lambda expects a handler function that takes in two parameters, that is, event and context, if it is a Python runtime. Let me give you a bit more information about event and context. Event is an object formed from a JSON formatted string that represents the action, I didn't want to reuse the word event, or the trigger that caused the invocation of the Lambda. For instance, if our Lambda was triggered by an upload to S3, then the event will contain the information about the object being uploaded. I've put a link in the description below for an event example. Context provides information about the invocation, function, and execution environment for your Lambda. So you can use it to check things like memory allocation or to retrieve the number of milliseconds left before the execution times out. We chose edit code inline, so this is where we're going to write our code. But before we do that, I just want to show you a few more things. So just scroll down with me to basic settings. This is where we set the memory and the timeout for the Lambda. You can also put a description here, but it is not mandatory. The function is allocated CPU proportional to the memory configured, and it defaults to 128 megabytes. Timeout is the longest amount of time that the function can run for. If your function isn't finished by this time, Amazon will just kill it. The timeout defaults to 3 seconds, but you can put 1 second as the smallest unit, and the maximum timeout is 15 minutes. This means that you can have a Lambda function that runs for more than 15 minutes as of today, the 13th of December, 2019. The 128 megabytes memory for our function is okay, but the 3 seconds timeout is too much. So I'm just gonna reduce it to 1 second. Remember, this is a configuration page, so we can get to see what we have already configured. For example, the execution row that we set up when we're creating the Lambda. With this, I think we are ready to write and test our Lambda function. So just scroll up to the inline editor, but before we change anything, we just need to make sure that everything is wired up correctly. That is, can we run this default Lambda function as it is without any changes? If it runs, it means that everything is wired up correctly, and then we can modify this Lambda to perform the tasks that we want. In this instance, add two numbers and return the result. To test this Lambda function, we need to create a test configuration, and we do that by clicking on this test button here. It will allow us to create a test configuration. There are many templates you can choose from to mimic the event that you're building the Lambda for. If you click on the drop-down here, you'll be able to see all the events. You can also even search for a particular event. For instance, if I just want the S3 events, I just type in S3 and it will filter the results and just show me the events that pertain to S3. We're going to use the event template Hello World, so just click anywhere outside the search bar. Under event name, we're going to call our event my test event. We're not going to send anything to our Lambda, so we can delete the key value pairs here. But take note, we will leave the braces there. They are required. If we remove them, we'll get an error because the test event has to be in JSON format. So the braces are important. Just click on create to create our test event. As you can see, we now have a test event called my test event, and it is displayed next to our test button. Now that we have a test event, we can test the wiring of our Lambda function by clicking on the test button here. If everything is wired up correctly, we're going to expect a return statement that is this information here, that is the information in the brackets, and we'll see it in two places. The first place is a pop-up that will come up here, and the second place is under execution results. And if it has a status of succeeded, then we know that everything is wired up correctly. So let's just click on test and see. As you can see, we've got a succeeded status, and we can expand details here to see the information. This, including the brackets, is what was returned, and if we check our Lambda function, this is what we are returning for our Lambda function. And if we check on the execution result, we have the same information. What we are returning here is the response. The execution result tab also shows information such as the request ID and the function logs. You can also see these function logs in AWS CloudWatch. If we scroll up to the pop-up, you can also see the same function logs, but it does give you a link to see these logs in CloudWatch. Now that we are happy that our Lambda is wired up correctly and it works, we can now modify the Lambda function to do the task that we want. The task that we want is for it to add two numbers and then return the result. So I'm just going to put my first number as 10. And then my second number as 20. And then I'm going to store the result in result. And then I'm going to return result in the body of the return statement. Click on save to save the changes. And once it's done, click on test. As you can see here, the body is 30, which is the result of adding 10 and 20. If we scroll up, we can also see the body has got 30, which is the result. You might be wondering, is it not possible to just return the result? Yes, it's possible. So I can delete this and just say return result. It will still work and it will just return the result. Save and then test. As you can see, the response is 30, which is the result of adding 10 and 20. If we scroll up, the result is just 30. The thing is, AWS introduced something called Lambda proxy, and for it to work, it requires a return statement that is at the minimum a status code as well as the body. It can also include things like content headers. We'll see this when we integrate our Lambda function with API Gateway. That is all for this video. In the next video, we're going to be connecting our Lambda function to API Gateway so that we can access it over HTTP. Thank you for watching. And please subscribe to support the channel if you haven't already.